Hey guys, it's the Infamous from the Infamous Chronicles. I wanted to let you know that all of our shows have partnered up with Civvy's Apparel. Civvy's Apparel is an online clothing store that takes donated military uniforms worn by our men and women in service, and they repurpose them into clothing like t-shirts, tank tops, hoodies, hats for men and women. It's an awesome brand. You guys have seen pictures of us all in the clothing, all over our social media. And what they do that's so special is they donate 10% of all of their sales to local veterans organizations. Now check this out. Go to civviesapparel.com and use our coupon code CHRONICLES20 to save 20% off your entire purchase. That's CHRONICLES20 for 20% off. Go ahead, check them out on their socials at Civvies Apparel or visit them online at civviesapparel.com. Thanks a lot, guys, for helping us support this great cause.
Hey, guys, it's the Infamous here. Before we jump into tonight's episode, I got to tell you about our sponsor, Audible. Audible gives you access to hundreds of thousands of audiobooks that you can listen to wherever it's convenient for you. Use our link, audibletrial.com/infamous, and not only do you get a free 30-day trial of the service, but you also get a free audiobook, Compliments of the Show. So head to audibletrial.com/infamous, get yourself a book, and get some money back into the show. Enjoy tonight's episode.
Hey, what's up, everyone, and welcome back to the Infamous Chronicles. This week we got our special one. It was a bit of a treat for me personally. Whenever you you get these cool celebrity guests, and they're fantastic. Don't get me wrong. I mean, to get on a podcast that started in the kitchen and be able to interview some people that you really look up to or encourage that you really want to participate in is extremely exciting. But then I get these unique opportunities where I actually get to sit down with friends and people that I've known for years and years and years and dive deeper into their psyche and their beliefs and their feelings. And this week was one of those opportunities. I got to sit down with my friend Stephen. Now, Stephen and I have known each other for over 15 years. Right after the Army, I got my first sales job at what was Singular Wireless at the time. This was the job, you guys have heard me joke about it on the podcast before, but where I had to go teach Denise Richards how to use a BlackBerry because it was the first ever BlackBerry. And when the Palm Trios were still out, that's when Stephen and I were slanging phones. That's how long ago that was. And we've remained in contact with each other. We have a daughter. They have a daughter. And ironically, his wife now, they were dating when I used to know him. And then they took a break and are now, you know, married and happy and wonderful. But she joined us as well. So it was a cool dynamic because we knew each other when we were all up to some shenanigans. And now we know each other when we're all adult parents and living successful lives. And it's exciting to hear how we've evolved as people. So Stephen and his wife, Alex, who's a therapist, an LCSW, joined us to talk about dad life during the pandemic. So that was another dynamic that him and I got to bro down on that we don't get to talk about, obviously, publicly, really at all. And I don't really dive a lot into fatherhood on the podcast, just out of protection for my daughter. So we were careful, but it was fun to talk about that and how we've been dealing with COVID as dads. And to add to the excitement is that Mrs. Infamous, my wife, and Firefox, one of the hosting members of this show, they run another show called Maternal Instincts, and they pretty much took over this episode, which was really fun because they also recorded their own episode with Alex. So this week we've got my wife, Mrs. Infamous, Firefox, and Alex Steric, therapist, interviewing Stephen and I about fatherhood during COVID. So it's a good episode. It's fun. It's actually deeper than I thought it was going to go, which was cool. But Steven's always a hoot. Alex has a super contagious little laugh there. And it was fun. Also, you get to hear my wife kind of tell me what she doesn't like about me. So always a plus, right? All right, guys. Well, enjoy. This is The Infamous Chronicles.
Okay, hi. You're listening to The Infamous Chronicles. Let me down.
Turn down for what?
Do you even know what's going on?
This is The Infamous Chronicles.
The Infamous Chronicles.
You only love me when you want punani.
Wait, what are we doing?
Pardon my French, but you're an asshole.
The Infamous Chronicles starts right now. Right now.
Did something supportive to vets last week for Veterans Day on November 11th. November's a big month in our house. Lots of things happen. And one of those things is that our friend's birthday, or their daughter's birthday, is on the same day as mine. She tried to steal it, but I've been around for, you know, a lot longer than her. So we're still going to call it mine for the sake of this podcast. But we have in studio, we have a full house. Our first five-person interview since COVID started in March. We have maintained not having guests in the house, as you guys know, through the shitty Zoom interviews we've been doing. But I do want to thank, we launched a clothing line last week, and we sold over 100 products in our first week. So thank you very much for that.
Wow.
It was really exciting. It's been a passion project of mine for a while. And a past guest of ours, Lenny, she beat me to it and launched it and exposed me to a very different way of doing it. And it helped tremendously and kind of broke the glass ceiling of having our own product line, which is really exciting. So if you haven't seen it, just go to letsbeinfamous.com. There's stuff for men, women, kiddos, and pets, all kinds of goodies. And but if you have to be wearing clothes, you might as well be repping the fact that you listen to this great show. So also, I wanted to let you guys know for the holidays, since we're kicking off, this is Thanksgiving week. So I hope you survive that. But if you are shopping for the holidays, use promo code Infamous and save $10 off your first purchase. So let's go first with our roster tonight is myself, the Infamous, and Firefox.
Hello.
We also have from Firefox's show, Maternal Instincts, my smoking hot wife, Mrs. Infamous.
Woo woo.
She's on Couch Mic. It's our first time doing Couch Mic.
It is. It's kind of weird.
Yeah, since it's like an older mic and we're hoping the sound sounds as good.
Yeah, I am hoping. I mean, I'm 2 feet taller than the rest of you. I can honestly say that's the first time in my life.
Ever.
But yeah, we'll see how this goes.
And our guest tonight is, ladies first. So I have in studio Alex Steric. She is a therapist in the Ventura County community. I think she does most of LA as well, right? Or just Ventura County?
Yeah. I mean, I'm in Westlake Village when I'm in office, not in office currently, COVID. Yeah. But yes, so Westlake Village, so LA, Ventura County, wherever you're at.
Perfect. So Alex Steric works with children. She is, she's going to come back.
Yes.
With her business partner and talk about this great opportunity that they're putting out, which is a web series. That's all you're going to get on it for now. But make sure you stay tuned. And then right after that, she's going to give birth. Because she's sitting in front of me and she looks about 2 months pregnant, but apparently she's also ready to pop. So I don't really know how the math works on that anatomy, but it's 2020. So who knows? And to her left, I have her smoking hot husband, who I have had the pleasure of being friends with now for over 15 years. I've been friends with Alex for over 15 years, too. But
I guess.
Yeah, wow.
She kind of left for a while and then held Stephen at gunpoint and said, you're going to date me or else?
Yeah.
Or else.
That's totally how it went down.
And if you've ever been intimidated by a man, let me tell you, there's nothing more intimidating than me in Steven's presence, looking directly at his gorgeous face, and then knowing that he speaks French and Spanish fluently.
Yes.
So wow. I'm proud to introduce the pussy monger, Stephen Steric, who is also a business owner, correct? You're a co-owner of a construction company, also in the Ventura County area. So we've got like a smorgasbord of entrepreneurs up in this bee.
Thank you for that warm welcome. I really appreciate it.
Which part did you like best?
The warmest part.
Yeah. So the genesis of tonight's episode is Stephen thought it'd be fun to, I said, hey, you've never been to my podcast. Come on it. And he said, perfect. Let's talk about being dads. And I was like, oh, fuck. Okay.
Anything but that.
Yeah. And who better than to get into pandemic parenting and our dadding skills than our spouses? And the most ferocious female host we've ever had in Firefox.
Well, thank you.
Also noteworthy, Alex was a guest on your show that also came out today.
Yes. A phenomenal guest. Oh, my gosh.
Apparently.
Thank you.
You and Mrs. Infamous are fighting for being her
best friend spot.
Correct.
Yes. Yeah.
Yes, we'll be dueling in the backyard later. I expect you to film it.
If there are women fighting, I will film it.
Women fighting over women.
I'll bring the mud.
Yeah. Well, perfect. Alex or Steven's gonna be.
We'll turn it into a spa
day. We're still friends.
Oh, for that he's gonna bring mud.
Get minis and pennies after.
Not the kind you like.
Has she gotten you to do a mani-pedi yet?
No.
Never. You've never done either.
No.
Me neither.
No, blatant refusal.
Yeah.
No. Whoa, whoa, whoa. That is so not true.
That's true. Actually, never man-eater
no, petty. No, no, no. But you are not blatant refusal as Steven is. You are...
Terrified.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. That's a shame thing. But frankly... My feet are a punishment in the Holocaust.
Those poor people.
Terrible.
Frankly, I would do it. I've just never actually been like in the moment to do it.
Like a tattoo?
Well, usually what happens is we drive up to like the nail salon place and I'm like, all right, babe, gotta go, bye. And that's it. And so I leave her there and I pick her up an hour later.
It seems like refusal to me.
Slightly.
Yeah.
Tomatoes, tomatoes. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. If you've seen his feet, you would go, oh, okay,
so
got it.
So we must have been swimming in the same pools as children.
Uh-huh, definitely. Yeah, the creek. That's what we call it.
Where the sign says... radioactive chemicals. And we're like, that's fine. Made Spider-Man super, so I'll be fine.
No offense, Fukushima.
All right, so Steven and I are going to open up about our dad side of it. And if you want to hear the mom side of it, go to Firefox's other podcast with Mrs. Infamous, Maternal Instincts. But this is the dad side of it. So here we go.
Here we go.
Here we go.
All right.
What you got?
All right. Well, I want to hear first how the misses have been handling your dadding during the pandemic.
Ooh. Oh, Jesus.
My. Wow, we're starting out with that one.
That's right. Right out the gate.
Wow. Where's the beginning?
That's how I do.
All right. Guest first, Alex.
All right. I'll go for it.
What you got?
No, I will say as with everything with COVID, I mean, man, what a shit show. I have been really impressed, though, with how my lovely husband has navigated parenting during these times. And then also just like work life. So I would say, like, overall, I have felt really supported by him, which has been really nice. I'm not gonna lie, there are some moments at times where I'm like, dude, step it up. Like, I need some support here. Just a little bit. But.
In the bedroom?
Right now, not so much.
Pregnancy is sexy.
It might be to you, but, you know, when you're the one going through it, not so much. No, but I will definitely say, I think communication has been really important. Cause there are moments where I think, like, I can see that he wants to mentally kind of tap out a little bit or needs to tap out a little bit. Mm-hmm. Or I need that as well. So,
I think everybody gets,
yeah, which for the record is fine.
Absolutely. Yeah.
You know, yeah, yes. As long as everyone gets to,
of course,
not at the same time, of course.
No, that's when everybody goes to their own rooms. Yeah. That's tapping out. Yeah. Everybody needs their mental time.
All right, kiddo.
Out
yeah. It's tap out time. You're on your own for an hour.
We never ask our toddler to make us dinner, you know? So
you're no hot pockets.
You're
in
not
the
there
freezer.
Yet, huh? Come
on. No, but I would say, like, the more we've been able to talk about it and kind of have, like, all right, like, what's our plan? You know, like, who's doing what today? Mm-hmm. That's been pretty important.
Yeah, definitely.
Because. I think in the beginning, we were all just kind of like in survival mode of let's just figure this out and just try to get through the day. And so, I mean, I think I've really leaned on him to be like, I feel like a crap parent today. Like, I feel like we just sat her in front of the TV for most of the day.
Is that bad?
You know,
depends on
wait
the day.
Hold on. So I'm a shitty parent?
I'm taking notes now.
Wait, I gotta ask, Alex, what's it like being, your question was great, Firefox, and I'm stalling for Mrs. Infamous over here, but what's it been like being pregnant during COVID and the whole process of the hospital visits and everything?
Yeah, it's been rough. Really, like, isolating, especially having the experience of being pregnant before, so I have something to compare it to.
Yeah.
And it sucked because, you know, he hasn't been able to come to any of the visits. He was able to come to the first appointment, and then thankfully he has been able to come to the ultrasounds, but... are like regular OB appointments. Like,
they ousted me.
They
saw me walk in the building. They were like, never again.
They're like, that guy's not allowed in here.
Really?
Yeah. It's been, it definitely feels like I'm in this, like, kind of on my own in a way, at least at appointments and stuff.
Which has got to be weird for you because you're, like, built to be supported.
Mm. Thank you for that. I appreciate that.
Well, yeah, and it's been really, really shitty for him because he's, like, he was really mad when we showed up for our appointment and they're like, you can't come in.
I would be, too.
Like, what? Yeah. What do you mean he can't come in?
It takes a lot to get Stephen mad.
Yeah, it does. It does, but he was pissed.
Will there be restrictions during the... Because you have a scheduled C-section, right?
Yeah. So
Stephen's doing it.
Yes.
At home.
Yeah.
YouTube.
Yep. Amazon's got knife sales on Black Friday.
and tape.
But will there be restrictions to his time there? Or once that happens, it's like, no, I'm in here no matter fucking what.
So he's like, you're allowed to have one support person in, whoever that is, and that's it. And then right now, with the way things are, he can come and go. But that's it. So, and we'll see what happens.
And it could
change,
unfortunately.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. It could change. So... Mm-hmm.
Are you guys at Los Robles?
Yep.
Yeah, us mm-hmm. too. Yeah.
Yeah. So we'll see what happens. But yeah, it's kind of sucks because our daughter won't be able to come to the hospital and, you know, she's going to have to.
I guess I gave bad pretext too. So you guys have a 3-year-old.
We do.
Daughter.
Yeah.
Let's call her Mini Steric for now. And then you have another daughter on the way in December.
That's
yes.
right.
End of the month scheduled C-section.
Uh-huh. That's right.
Yeah. Okay. So
New
I didn't
Year's
give that
baby
context.
Just before.
Yeah. Yeah. You have two little girls.
Mm hmm.
That's awesome.
Yeah. It is. For a dad, it's amazing.
I never wanted a son.
Yeah.
Did you?
You know, I did. I wanted a son and a daughter, but then after having an amazing daughter, I want another one.
Once you have a daughter, it's game over.
Yeah.
That's it.
Well, and I also see, like, my other friends who have sons. I'm like, I don't want that.
Oh, yeah. Like a little voice. Somehow.
No offense, Firefox. No,
that's all I have for boys.
Firefox is like a miracle worker with boys because her sons are the 0.01% of sons on this planet.
It's because I have a magical uterus.
Oh, and it makes them special?
It does. Extremely special.
So if you want to have a son... Contact Firefox.
Yeah, we'll see.
It's $48,000
right.
per child.
whoa, hold on. I was just about to say if the price is right.
Did I lowball it?
You did. It's a lot of work.
Well, congratulations, though, for real.
Thank you.
It's exciting. I'm glad you didn't steal
much.
My birthday twice.
Mm. Yeah, we won't steal it a second time.
Yeah, and you'll never tell her, ever.
No.
November 19th is yours. No one we know of any importance shares this day with you at all. Especially that knucklehead Jay.
She'll learn eventually.
One day?
Yeah, one day. She will. I promise you that.
I appreciate that.
Yeah, of course.
Very sweet.
And then one day you guys can have a co-birthday.
But she wasn't supposed to, right?
Didn't she come early? Yeah.
She came early, yeah.
That's right. Her due date was the 24th.
Which is our daughter's
right.
birthday.
Uh-huh.
Which
exactly.
is
which would have been
wow.
incredible.
Yeah.
It would have been
who fucking wants to share
forever.
A birthday
right.
with Jay?
It would have been a lot more appropriate.
Yeah. Although, the downside to that, which Mrs. Infamous has this year, is every 2 years or 3 years?
2 years.
Every no, 2 years, her our daughter's birthday is on Thanksgiving.
Right, mm. right.
So you'd have to deal with that. So this year, that's Mrs. Great. Infamous's birthday is on Thanksgiving.
Yeah.
Yeah. And she made this
Happy
stupid choice of claiming Thanksgiving as her holiday.
Oh, whoa. That was you.
All you.
No.
I don't believe in Thanksgiving. It's a dumb holiday.
No, that was the first
I would rather
time
order pizza
when...
and watch football.
No, that
don't
was
even start.
No, that was when Miss Infamous was born, or Baby Infamous, not Miss, obviously, but Baby Infamous was born, and you were like, "Yep, nope, we're not going anywhere, so you guys can all come to us." Oh, look at that! It's our new tradition. I was like, "Say what?" So yeah,
that was a house of lies built on a weak foundation.
Oh no, it wasn't.
No.
If anybody knows you, they would believe me.
There's two and a half. The only truth to your story is that obviously I'm not going anywhere when my kid is born.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yep.
No, okay. I don't like me. Anyway, so how am I doing as a dad?
You know, I wish that I would have known.
Why
Alex
is your middle
playbook.
Finger up?
Yeah, uh-huh. If only. No, I wish I would have grabbed that playbook from Alex's sheet where they touch base in the morning and they really set up the day of knowing who owns what, because that could have helped a lot.
Do we do that?
I mean, not. It's
okay.
Mean,
maybe
let's
not every day. All right. Maybe I read into it a little bit more. But I mean,
I really like that idea.
That, yeah. Even if I touch base once a week, I feel like it's a good foundation. Way to try to sell an idea as Alex is.
Well, like, I'm going to subscribe to it. I'll take credit.
Yeah. Alex was onto something. I love it.
Hey, as you heard, it wasn't my idea.
Yeah. I mean, it's basically like, hey, I tap out on laundry and dishes, so I'm good for today. And then you take on the reins. I'm in. I'm so in on that.
What do you think about that?
About?
Yeah. Huh? What?
Well, since I did all the laundry and dishes today, I'm fine with that idea.
Interesting. Interesting.
And is laundry and dishes enough? I feel like that's just two things.
Well, okay. So.
Whoa, Ash. Pushing the limits so now. Firefox.
So we kind of have an unstructured structure of like, so we live in a house with a front and backyard, and like I do all the yard work. And then,
What?
Oh.
Will you let me finish?
Yeah, okay. Yeah. Oh. I was just curious about our gardener.
But that comes with a handicap of I enjoy doing it. I love yard work. I love gardening. Uh-huh. I take a lot of pride in the way our front and our backyard looks.
Come on over.
Yeah, I'm upset. Well, I like your backyard too. You have the whole sand thing going.
Yeah, I don't cut a blade.
So, okay. Don't cut a blade. So, I made it about 5 months into COVID. Well, I bought the lawnmower. When COVID started, we were like, all right, the gardener's got to go. Mm-hmm. Expenses. We were both furloughed in the beginning. Mm-hmm. You know, thankfully, both of us still work, but our time was cut back. So we cut back on the gardener. And I don't mean to like, okay, white privilege or bitching or whatever word you want to use to describe this. Like, it takes a fucking lot to do the yard work every single weekend. Mm-hmm. It's like 4 to 6 hours of your day, easily.
If you're not a professional and you don't do it every single day, right?
Yeah, and the fucking edges are never straight.
Well, and that's the thing about being a perfectionist is that you'll never get them straight.
Which I am.
Right?
I'm like super OCD about that.
But if you're a professional landscaper, gardener, whatever you want to call it.
An hour.
It's usually, it's even less than that. It's a half hour for a standard side house, right?
Right.
But they do it day in and day out, and that's their job.
But our gardener, as great as they are, I love our gardener. He's a wonderful man. And we did cave and rehire the gardener in August. Thankfully, she was like, yeah, go ahead. It's $125 a month. You can do it. Mm-hmm. And so they do the mowing and the edging. Mm-hmm. That's it.
Okay.
So that still gives me to be able to do, like, I got to do the roses and pull all the weeds and plant everything, which is fun for me, but it's also an activity. You know, I got to water every night, all these things, right? Uh-huh. But that isn't as much time as she puts in. So through that, now I'm helping with the laundry. I'm helping with the dishes.
Okay.
The one thing I haven't ventured into, full disclosure, is, like, I don't enjoy, I will do it, but I do not have any desire under any circumstances to cook.
Okay.
And that includes grilling.
I'm the one fucking
male on the planet.
Oh my gosh, yes, that's a new thing.
The second her brother moved into this house, I stopped grilling altogether.
No. He used to grill.
But then her brother moved in, and he likes grilling, so that is now his job.
So that's his program.
Yes, but as a caveat, I also learned how to cook a steak on the stovetop, which everybody likes. Mm-hmm. And so now that is the new grilling.
I see.
Got it.
So that responsibility got passed over to you because you're good at it.
It's just not something, and I get it. It's like it's a man card on the table kind of thing. I understand that it's like part of being a man is that you grill for your family, and I will do it. Like, it's not like I'll say no to it, but I'm not going out of my way to grill under any circumstances. Like,
is that why my grill doesn't work? Because I don't have a penis? So it doesn't work?
Not at all, because she will grill better than I can grill.
Oh.
Okay.
I thought it was like the man car.
Since we're being transparent, I'm just not good at it. And I don't like grilling for other people and not being good at it. It's not like it's an emasculating thing.
That's true. If you can't perform, why should you?
Exactly. Yeah. Right?
I thought it was practice makes perfect.
I'm gonna sign up to have sex with the hottest girl on the planet. Why and I don't give last up. Therefore the grill.
Yeah, disappointing.
And Kelly Mrs. Infamous can go out and just destroy a grill and cook the meanest steak you've ever had. And then my kid's like, ooh, the steak is delicious. It's better than dad's. And I'm like, well, then guess who's not grilling anymore?
Yeah,
because that's gone now.
Makes perfect sense.
Yeah. So I'm not justifying it. I'm just putting it out there. That's my honest thing. I don't mind laundry. I don't mind dishes. I have a pet. My one house pet peeve is dishes in the sink. So I'm like, okay with dishes. Uh-huh. I just don't like cooking.
So can I ask a question?
Sure.
Okay. This is for both of you, dads. So what do you feel like, what's something you feel like you could improve upon or do better in parenting during COVID times?
I don't think it's parenting and marriage-wise. I want, fucking unfortunately, everyone we know, I don't know about you guys and I don't mean to start a fight, but besides you, everyone we know, the fucking husband cooks. And I get it every time it comes up. It's like, Jay's a failure as a husband. Like, it's the way I feel. I wish I could turn that switch on. I am a creative person. I enjoy seeing something through to the end. The concept of cooking is like right up my alley. I just don't like it. Hmm. And it's a switch I wish I could flip. I would love to just like wake up at 6, have dinner ready for the girls, and I'll do it like once a week, and then I'm like, fuck this. I wish I would cook more. I'm a good cook. I just don't like doing it.
Yeah.
And I would love to be like, all right, I'll cook, you know, every other night or every night, whatever it is. And you do breakfast and I'll do dinner. Something more like that. Right. I just struggle with getting motivated to do it. And I don't like it. And I wish I can get around that. And I should be able to get around that. And I'm not making excuses for it. Just telling you, that's the thing I wish I could improve.
Okay. Fair enough.
Yeah. Hmm. Besides that, it's just an excuse to hang out with my kid all fucking day. I mean, the activities that I've gotten to do through COVID. I'm probably the only person you know that don't mind COVID. Mm-hmm. And it's a struggle saying that because it offends a lot of people. And I understand that a lot of people are really affected by this negatively. But for me and my job and my time, like when I got laid off the weekend, the Friday before my daughter was born, I was fired from my job. And I had the unfortunate blessing of having 3 whole months with her, just us, one-on-one, while Mrs. Infamous was making the bread. And it was a time I wouldn't trade for anything in the world. I was miserable, and it felt awful, but it ended up being perfect.
Right.
And now here I am in this opportunity where I get to work, be employed, make money, and hang out with her.
Right.
Is awesome for me. And it's like, it's time I'm never going to be able to get back. We've all been working long enough to know that, like, this is never going to happen again, God forbid, hopefully, ever. This is the most time we're ever going to have in our homes, with our spouses, with our kids. Even if you're an 8-hour a day, you're still at home 8 hours a day for most of the country.
Right.
You know, the people that are still out there in the restaurant industry and the first responders and the retail.
Right.
You're trading your time, and we appreciate that. But for a larger percentage than not, we're home right now with our kids, and people are going crazy, but I'm like, oh, this is cool. What are all the cool things I can now do?
Yeah. So. Well, I think that's a good way of looking at it, looking at what opportunities are coming out of it instead of just seeing it as, oh my God, this is like the worst thing that's ever happened to us. So.
We did a whole episode on like the positives of it, and the unfortunate part is like Mrs. Infamous is not like that. So it's a battle. I'm not the chore guy, and so she default becomes that. She's not the traditional, quote-unquote, like, fun, silly person. And then I become that. And we resent each other for those two things. Mm-hmm. You know? So.
Mrs. Infamous, I just want to say, fuck playing. I hate it, too.
I know, right?
I just want you to know you're not alone. Yeah. I'll hang out with my 17-year-old, but my sweet, sweet 6-year-old, you're on your own, kid.
And it's funny because we were always like, we're never going to be the tablet TV people, right? And unfortunately, anybody during COVID that says that they're not in some way or shape or another relying on that somehow is lying through their teeth.
Well, they're clearly not having meetings either, work meetings or any sort of outer interaction.
I mean, I don't love it. It's funny because like, they'll be studying the long-term effects of this. Like, you know, their kids in high school will be studying what happened to this generation of their education. You know, my second grader, her reading abilities are totally stunted as a result of it happening right as her reading capacity was developing, you know. And we have a toddler. God forbid we had a high school student. Couldn't fucking imagine not being able to get ready for college. All college forever now is going to have to handicap the next 12 years of kids knowing that they miss an entire year of school, more or less.
Like, insane.
People are like, oh, your kid's in school? Yeah, for 2 hours a fucking day.
Yeah.
What is she learning? You know, that's basically, she's in tutoring, more or less. You know?
But to the other point, college is a lot of self-accountability, which high schoolers aren't getting. So now they're getting that. They have to show up. They have to log into their classes, you know, and it's more on them rather than coming into campus every day and then just going where you know you have to go. It's, you know, it's totally more self-discipline.
I agree, and I do think that is a character strength, but also the average 18, 19-year-old kid isn't built to do an entire semester of college in 3 months.
Right.
You know, that's a
lot of Well, and be taught by their parents, too.
Right? And neither are our parents qualified to teach anything.
I'm not.
No. I'm not.
Well, especially Lord,
I look at my kids' math
changing.
In second grade, and I'm out.
Yeah, no.
Stephen has 12 dogs. And his wife gives him 10 dogs. How many chihuahuas are there?
4.
When the
what color?
And then I'm like, I call her, and I'm Mrs. Infamous. It didn't fucking mention chihuahuas in this question. I don't know what to do. You explain it, and she's like, "Fuck you."
Uh-huh. Read it again. You'll figure it out.
And then it's like, write it out, and then you have to teach your kid like, what's 2 + 2? 4. Well, write that out. Mm-hmm. Well, why? I know what it is. I don't fucking know because the system says you have to. Yeah. Jesus. It's frustrating. You know, we didn't do that.
No, we didn't.
You don't know math? You're stupid. It wasn't write it out.
But here's your participation award.
Right, yeah. Right. I mean, literally, I took 2 years of math in high school. I never even was required to take algebra. Seriously.
What do you mean?
I never took algebra.
Oh.
I had 2 years of math in
high school. You're probably smarter because
How'd you swing that, man?
That's the way math worked when I was in high school, is you were required to take 2 years.
What?
That was fucking it. But I was in physics because physics is visual. Couldn't do algebra.
Uh-huh.
Because fuck algebra.
Uh-huh.
Because when are you going to use that in life? Unless you're a fucking engineer, you don't need algebra. Like, I know you do because you're in construction.
It's pretty simple.
Thanks, bro.
Well, no, what I'm talking about, algebra. What I'm talking about is construction.
Like, you're just stupid.
No, construction's real easy. The tape measure tells you exactly what it is. It says 1 foot 2 inches and 1/4.
Like, yeah, the but tape measures you're make out, like, easy. For A a lot. Like, okay, if this is this and this is that, then A must be this.
Sometimes. Yeah. Most of the time it's already spelled out, right? Because that's why we have architects. Architects put all the measurements on the plans, and all we have to know how to do is read a tape measure.
You basically buy a Lego set with the instructions.
That's pretty much it, right? Yeah, it's like a modular built home, but we just have to make sure that like we don't go too big.
Got it.
The scale is proper. That's it.
So I bogarted that question. What is your answer to the dad question that Stephen or that Alex proposed?
What?
Do you remember my question?
What could I do?
I mean, it was
you guys don't see how I'm looking at her right now. What could I do better as a father during COVID?
Yeah.
I think being more present and not worrying about the issues of the world. I think being a more present dad and partner is the most important thing that you can do for your entire family. No matter what the world has to give you, the more attention that you can pay in your household will reap the benefits or will multiply the benefits or whatever. Mm-hmm. It's gonna pay dividends later on, right? Because your kid knows when you're not talking to them. Your kid knows when you're looking at your phone and you're not.
Right. They totally.
My daughter.
They give you the fuckiest look ever.
My daughter literally says to me, "Put your phone down."
Yeah, ours too.
And she, you know, right, she's not even 3 years old. She'll be 3 years old in a few days.
Right.
She already knows. She gets it, right? And I'll say, if I have to make a work call or something like that, "Hey, I'm sorry I have to make this work call," or "I'm doing a work thing," or whatever on my phone, she'll wait patiently for about 40 seconds.
Yeah. And they have no concept of the time. They're like, "So how long is that going to take?" 30 minutes.
Yep.
How long is 30 minutes?
Uh-huh.
One show.
Uh-huh.
Okay, well, exactly. I'm going to put a show on. And then my daughter's gotten smart enough. "Alexa, set an alarm for 30 minutes.
"Don't do it. Oh, and there she
By
goes.
"By the way, I can notify you on all your devices if you don't hear your timer right away."
You know, it's better than street racers.
Just be quiet.
So really, I think what's most important, especially in a time where, like, right now in Europe, right, we have mass quarantine. We have, you know, quote-unquote lockdowns, right? My mom lives in France in the southwest part of France. and they're allowed to go out. They're allowed to leave their house. They have to fill out a piece of paper, right, a document, before they leave their house right now. And if they get stopped by the police, they have to furnish this piece of paper immediately and say, this is what I'm doing. I'm going to the store, or I'm driving an elderly person to a doctor's appointment, or I'm doing whatever it is that's essential at that moment, right?
Yeah.
And I think we take for granted in this country that we have free travel. We can move freely around the country. We can go to whatever it is that we want to do within reason.
With really very limited restrictions, all things considered.
Absolutely. Very limited, right? And being in a state, in a coastal state, mm-hmm. right? Like California or Washington or Oregon or on the other side of the coast, right? New York or New England, right? We have the most restrictive rules out of the whole entire country. And it's still really not that restrictive if we think about it.
Right. It's a borderline inconvenience at most.
Yeah, right. It is. Right. And so we have to kind of follow these rules.
Yeah.
And so, you know, what ends up hurting is our kids, right? So our kids can't go to a playground or something like that, right? Yeah. And so I think that what's really important, going full circle back into being a dad during a pandemic, is spending the time with your kids and being there, being present with your family. So that way you can ensure that your kid still had a great time,
yeah.
right? But you kind of, you got creative. You made paper airplanes. Yeah. You did whatever it was that you had to do, so that way your kid isn't just glued to a screen the whole entire time.
I love that you said that too, because like my whole agenda, self-belief has always been, and I hold myself accountable to this, is that one day our daughter will tell her kids the story of COVID,
mm-hmm.
you know, just like all the generations experience, you know, the Great Depression and mm-hmm. the Black Plague and all these things, right? It's a part of our fabric now forever. No matter Absolutely. Where you live on this planet, you can't hide from this.
Yeah.
I don't care what you believe. So everyone knows in some way, shape, or form, this is going on
uh-huh.
and it is changing the way I'm living my life, right? Whether you think it's a conspiracy or not, it's still affecting everything you do all day, right?
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
So my whole agenda and perspective has been like one day our kid will tell her kids or her grandchildren the story of how she experienced this.
Mm-hmm.
And I want that story to be like, you know, people were poor, food was scarce, you know, toiletries were scarce in the beginning. Mm-hmm. People didn't know what to do. And, you know, my dad was taking action figure pictures with me and creating forts in the backyard and making mm-hmm. campsites out back. And my parents took me to the beach. And my mom was coming up with fun ways to make me have a 5-person birthday party instead of a drive-through birthday party. And, you know, for Halloween, we prohibited our daughter from trick-or-treating. So Mrs. Infamous and Action Figure Junkie, who does another show with me, his wife, Tammy, the two of them came up with like a whole night. Scavenger hunts, games, pumpkin carving. It was like, it was Halloween still.
Oh, that's cool.
And that's the thing is like, they will, your kids, no matter who you are, will tell about how you handled this.
Yeah.
And you're the only person on the planet that can decide how that story goes.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm always aware and conscious of that. And I may not keep my job forever, but we're all struggling with money. We're all struggling with a sense of self. We're all struggling with a sense of purpose right now.
Mm-hmm.
And the most important thing that you can relay to your kids is that honesty. Like, hey, I'm hurting too. This isn't awesome for me either.
Mm-hmm.
Let's figure out a way to make today awesome and we'll deal with tomorrow when it happens.
Mm-hmm.
And one day this will go away and it sucks balls wearing a mask to school, just like it sucks balls wearing a mask to work. I don't like it any more than you do. But that's what we got to do.
Yeah.
You know?
And the, you know, kids are very malleable, right? So
super.
They're going to see their situation. They're going to adapt to it very quickly. And I think you're absolutely right. Like, it's our duty to make sure that they have a great example
mm-hmm.
on how we can all get through whatever it is we're going through, whether it be this pandemic that we're all living through and parenting through,
right?
Or whether it be something like a bully at school.
Mm-hmm.
Right, any of these things that we go through, we teach the fundamentals now
mm-hmm.
to our kids to make sure that they have the tools and the resources to be better people than we are.
Of course. That's always the goal, for sure. And it's unfortunate, too, because, like, adding on to the pandemic, and I don't mean to go down this road, but, like, there's a lot of other things going on, too, that they're being exposed to,
right.
for better or worse, right? And we don't need to get into them. It's not a political episode, but there's just a lot. It's been a lot for the last 8 months for everybody. Yep. For the whole planet, it's been a lot. A lot of shit going on.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And it's about acknowledging that and then processing that and choosing the amount that you're going to allow that to affect you. Mm-hmm. And then showing that truth to your kids. Like, it's not, you can't show them, like, you know, I'm offended by Black Lives Matter. That's not your place or business to tell them. Mm-hmm. But you can show them how I believe that these things were important, so I participated in them in this way. Mm-hmm. Or I believe that this wasn't important to me, so I didn't participate in it. Mm-hmm. You don't have to, like, expose them to the nitty-gritty, but you have to expose them to the narrative, and you have to choose the way they see that narrative. And, you know, we have a responsibility for that. And unfortunately, that goes both ways, too. There's going to be a lot of fucking shitty people that come out of the result of that. And there's going to be a shit ton of COVID babies. Uh-huh. COVID babies are the new baby boomer.
Hey, we got a COVID baby right here.
I mean, it was planned, though. It's not like it was because of COVID that this happened.
Steven's like, it's March and we're locked in. We're getting pregnant.
We banged in COVID.
Clearly that happened.
That means it's a COVID baby, right?
It's just the way that math works, but sorry.
You know, I think one thing that's important to remember for everybody is, you know, when you have your partner or, you know, trying to raise your kids or anything like that, I think it's really important to just listen. Right? That's one of the biggest things that sometimes we forget how to do. Mm-hmm.
Well, we put a handicap on their intelligence a lot, too. Mm. And you and I were talking out back while these guys were recording the last episode about how black and white kids can be, and if only.
Yeah.
You know? And as adults, like, the gray area is the confusing area.
Yeah.
You know? And it needs to exist. It's healthy. It's important for the gray area to exist. But as kids, it's either right or it's wrong.
Yeah.
And when they tell you, too, and you're just like, God damn it, you're so smart. Mm-hmm. You know, and you're like, did I contribute to that? Like, yeah. What did I do to help you come to this conclusion? Because I want to repeat that.
Yeah.
You know, and it's sometimes my kids come to bad conclusions too, and I have to be like, ooh, what did I do to get us here? Because mm-hmm. I got to walk these steps back, mm-hmm. you know, and too, like, they see us frustrated. We're obviously fighting, you know. We're prisoners in this home. We have roommates, mm-hmm. which dramatically exemplify the fighting and the consciousness that we have to possess at all times. We have mm-hmm. two other people that go to jobs every day that come home. We have to be responsible for that too. Mm-hmm. And I want to always be remembered as someone that handled those decisions as constructively and best as possible. And I don't ever want to be remembered as perfect ever. And I don't ever want to trick my kid into thinking that I am. Mm-hmm. You know,
that's a really good point.
She has to see that I fucked up during this and that Mrs. Infamous fucked up during this, or else it's pointless. Mm-hmm. You know, she would have learned nothing if she doesn't learn that we're also making mistakes every day. You know,
and it's okay to do that.
It's part of all ages of life.
Yeah.
You know, I don't want my kid to be a participation trophy kid. That's just me personally.
Mm-hmm. Same here.
And that comes from being somebody that can be wrong and strive to be better next time. Mm-hmm. You have
to not be the best at everything, because nobody is and nobody should be. So, and
yeah, that message is terrible. You know, not your, not what you just said. The message.
Wow.
Well, then, I guess I'm leaving.
There is an agenda that some people take that you do have to be that way or that you should be rewarded just for showing up. And it's like, well, they should be awarded for trying always.
Right.
Effort has to be appreciated and rewarded, but you have got to learn how to lose. You have got to learn how to fall down. You have got to learn those things, or you're just going to be a pompous asshole.
Yeah.
It just, sorry. And I'm not meaning to offend anyone. I'm just not a participation trophy guy. And I'm also not a first place is the only place that matters guy.
Of course not.
I'll be just as supportive of my second, third, 15th place kid. Cause it's like, hey, you came out, you earned that trophy. Next year, wouldn't it be awesome to get 14th place?
Sure.
How can we get there?
Well, because, like you said, it's all about the effort. It's not about the outcome. Right. So, you know, you put in the effort, then... And guess what? The more you put in the effort, the more you're going to get the outcome that you want to get. So
100%. We've got our kid in Krav Maga right now, and the thing I love about it is the belt structure. She's never going to get a first place trophy. She'll either get her next belt or she won't. Mm-hmm. And her actions will lead to that reward, mm-hmm. which is, I love it. I'm like, why didn't I get my kid into karate earlier? Because it's just freaking genius. It's a great discipline tool mm-hmm. to say, you're here, you're putting the effort in, like mm-hmm. you just said. And the amount of effort you put in will result in you achieving this thing. Mm-hmm. The amount of effort you don't put in will prolong you from achieving this thing. Mm-hmm. It's up to you.
Well, I mean, that's a great setup for life, too.
100%.
Yeah. Everything that you do or try to do in life, right? You get in, or sorry, you get out what you put in.
Oh, yeah.
It's plain and simple. It's like
just like the first job you had, you were a way worse employee than you were for the second and absolutely. The third. And now
I was,
you
know? Terrible at my first job.
Jesus, right? Yeah. I stole on my first job. I worked at Blockbuster. I can't tell you how big my DVD collection was. I would put them in a trash bag and throw them in the trash out back.
Oh my gosh!
Which got me fired from the job you and I worked at together.
That's very true. Years That's very later, true. Yeah.
Right.
Uh huh.
But had those mistakes not happened, I probably would have been arrested later. I had to get caught then mm-hmm. to learn, oh, shit, unemployment sucks. Mm-hmm. I'm not going to steal anymore. Mm-hmm. I lost that round. I made sure I didn't lose any rounds after that.
Yeah.
Same kind of shit.
Yeah. I think that's, you know, one of the most important things, too, is, like, continuously growing and looking within yourself.
Oh, yeah.
Especially with being a parent, right? Mm-hmm. So, I know with being a dad, I've had these, like, phases, right? These levels, if you will, mm-hmm. right? Where I'm like... All right, I'm at level one, like the kid just came out. I'm at level zero. The kid just came out. I have no idea what I'm doing right now. But I'm going to figure it out a little bit here at a time, right? And so, like, with my kid being 3 years old now, I feel like I'm at level three, mm-hmm. right? So, like, every year something happens, right?
Yeah.
And just when I feel like I have it figured out.
Her teeth fall out.
I don't. Right?
You guys are at teeth falling out right about right now, right?
Oh, yeah. I think not we're getting closer to her, though.
Yeah. But yeah, just when I think that, like, oh, okay, she likes this or she likes that or anything like that.
This response works really well.
Yeah.
And it only works well for that time.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Too. Yeah. Mm-hmm. What works last week. How old is Mr. Fire? What's your... Screen
tiniest
name for your,
one or
tiny Firefox?
Great White?
Yeah, Great White Firefox. How old is he?
Six.
Okay. But see, you had the wherewithal.
Yes.
To have done, you were more or less done.
Right.
By the time you had your second son, you'd already raised a good kid and did the ups and downs. Is it way easier or do you hold yourself now to that standard?
It's completely different. I'm a completely different person. I mean, they're 11 years apart. So, mm-hmm. you know, it's night and day. But it is a little bit harder. And also, I'm more self-aware because I can apply what I regret doing from the first baby. And I have had enough self-reflection and enough time to know exactly what I would do differently with the second.
Well, you also had a different dynamic in that you were basically a single mom for the first one. And the second one, you have this incredible partner now.
Right.
Who also stepped in with your other one, too. And accepted him almost immediately as his son.
Yeah.
Which is great.
Yeah. But it is hard, like, going from a single parent, because I was a single parent for about 10 years, to a partnership, because I got to make all the rules. I got to make all the calls.
Ooh, interesting.
I got to, you know, be there for every boo-boo and, you know, and help in that way. But we also got that one-on-one, 100%, mm-hmm. where now my youngest has to share me, you know, with two other people, and that's harder for him.
Do you think co-parenting was more of a struggle for you because you didn't have to do it for 10 years? Do you think you have a co-parenting handicap?
Co-parenting my oldest, yeah.
Oh, your oldest. So on the one that is his. So on Mr. Firefox's Great White Firefox, you and Mr. Firefox share as a blood child of the two of you.
Yeah.
He chose to step in as a co-parent for the other one, whose father is still in his life as well.
Correct.
And I've heard good things about.
Yeah.
And your son speaks highly of him.
Yeah.
So is it harder having a second input on something you've already done or having a second input on this thing now where you're like, I've done it. I'm good. I know how to do this. What's harder for you?
It's harder when there's tries to be input on something that's mine.
Mm-hmm. Interesting.
Especially if it's disciplinary, because I'm like, whoa. Mm-hmm.
But then do you have to have separate disciplinary standards for your two boys?
No, I have to check myself. Because that's not acceptable to my partner. It's not acceptable to my son. You know, it's totally ego response, which is all me.
Yeah.
So I have to adjust that. Whereas we coming into it completely together with ours, the one that we share,
yeah.
You know, biologically. And so it's different because I don't hold as much ownership, I guess.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, no, I get it. I get what you're saying. And you, Firefox, and Steven have your parents split, and then I think Alex, me, and Mrs. Infamous, our original parents, are still together, mm-hmm. right?
Yeah.
Do you see that as a asset or a handicap when it comes with Steven, with your child?
The fact that his parents were divorced?
Yeah, like the co-parenting thing. Do you think that his parents being divorced helps that, empowers it, or do you think it kind of handicaps it a little bit?
I honestly think it's just given us both different perspectives, and we've been able to, I mean, I think as with anything, I don't think it necessarily matters whether your parents were together or not together. You're affected by your experiences with your parents regardless, mm-hmm. and that's going to affect your parenting.
Mm-hmm.
Bottom line.
Yeah.
So I think in becoming parents, there's a lot that has to be kind of worked through and figured out. I think you co-parent, whether you're bringing somebody new in or it's, you know, you've gotten married and now you're starting a family, it's still co-parenting. And it is, I mean, it's not like this easy thing. Like, no one gives you a manual that's like, here you go, this is how to do it. And like, you're going to be fine. You're not going to hit any roadblocks. Like,
I gave Steven a manual.
Look how that turned out.
I know, right? Well, she's made it 3 years, but.
But I will say, like, I think a lot of it is his mom raised him with a lot of, you know, values and ideals that were similar to the way that my parents raised me. And uh-huh. So I think that has made our parenting journey and co-parenting
way easier.
Yeah. I mean, it really has. Yeah.
I think the strength of you as a dad, too, is that you, whether it be an attribute of your mom or your father, I don't know which one. But you have from, I met you when you were 23, which is when you're in your stupidest, debaucheriest, most
sure.
shenanigan-est lifestyle,
it
right?
It was awesome.
It was awesome, right? But you have always been somebody from the day I met you that was extremely respectful of women. You were never condescending to females. You never mm-hmm. saw them as less than. So that was like imprinted on you very, very young. Mm-hmm. And I actually witnessed you stand up for female coworkers that we worked together with when they were being mistreated by male coworkers that we had together. And wow. It was one of the things that made me want to be your friend from the get-go.
Wow, I completely forgot about that, but thanks for bringing it up.
Yeah, no problem. I think that Mini Steric is going to be better off as a result of that because she has to see what it looks like for a man to treat a woman the right way.
Yeah.
You know, not that anything you're doing, Alex, isn't just as, if not more valuable.
No, but I totally agree with what you're saying.
Yeah. I mean, yeah. Your kid, when she starts dating, is going to demand the same level of respect from her partner, whether it be male or female. Mm-hmm. Fingers crossed female. Mm-hmm. I don't know. That's just where I'm at. But, you know, she's going to demand to be treated the way that you have always treated Alex.
Yeah.
And all the other women in your life, you know?
And we had talked about earlier about how what you're... If you have a daughter,
right,
your daughter is going to look for that perfect example of who you are as a father in their partner.
Mm-hmm.
Yep. And that's it.
Yep.
Yeah.
We're teaching them how to be treated by men.
Yeah.
Which is and terrifying.
Going back to your point earlier about, you know, me being raised by my mom mostly and respecting women, obviously I was predisposed to my mom's ideals of what, how a woman should be treated.
Yeah.
And I thank her for that endlessly because I really feel like I'm not I don't know how to say, like the ideal of a chauvinist male. I don't know how offensive that's going to be to a lot of people here, and I don't give a fuck, but the point is that, like, you got to treat women with respect, no matter what you do.
Right.
Because women are the ones that have the babies.
And, yes. So, and they run the world.
Yeah, most of the time.
Yeah.
Right? That they let us think that we do things, but they do all the things.
Right, yes. Yes. Do you think, so when you were a kid, was your mom originally from France,
yes.
came here, raised you, and then moved back when you were adult?
Correct.
You never lived in France?
I lived in France for school.
Okay.
As an adult for a little while.
So, I don't mean this, forgive my ignorance in this, but in France, is there the same movement towards the equality of women as there is here in the United States?
Very much so.
Okay. So,
very much so.
So that helped.
But in large cities, only.
Okay.
Right.
So yeah, the cultural norm is still very much like patriarchal, you know, and especially like how his mom was raised was very much like kind of like in Latino culture, you know, there's like the male is kind of considered like in charge and the one that you kind of look up to. So that's still culturally sort of the case with French culture. Although, like you were saying, especially in like the more like developed and populated
the greater
parts
metros.
Of France, there's definitely more of the movement of equality and supporting, you know, feminism and women and all of that.
I mean, frankly, in our country towns here in this country, in the U.S., it's more on the chauvinist side.
Yeah, right. Non-coastal cities, yes.
Right, and so, just greater metros in general, right? So, whether it be a place like in Texas, like Dallas, Austin, something like that, right? Or in Georgia, Savannah, things like that.
P.S. Good job, Georgia, Pennsylvania, Wisconsin, and Michigan for showing up this fucking time. We are super proud of you. Way to fucking stop that bully. That's my personal belief, and I don't reflect the beliefs of all the other four people here.
So, but in France, it goes the same way, right? So in the Paris metro, the Bordeaux metro, the Versailles, like the whole, all of the areas that have a high concentration of people, you see more acceptance of different walks of life.
Mm-hmm.
And you also see, dare I say, better parenting skills with less barriers,
mm-hmm.
right? Less racial barriers, less they, them, there, are, thou, whoever mm-hmm. barriers, right? And
well, do you have a lot of race barriers in Europe?
Absolutely.
Yeah.
There are immigration and emigration from different countries in France or in Europe is way more prevalent than what we have here in the U.S., right?
But that's more cultural than it is physical, right?
No, very physical.
Oh, really?
Very physical, right? So in the States here, right, we have Canada to the north and we got Mexico to the south.
That's it.
We pretty much have two borders. That's right. It, right? Other than people flying in, right? But physical borders in Europe, you have a melting pot, right? You literally have a fondue of people.
Yeah.
And they're all trying to get the same piece of cheese.
Yeah. And most of those countries are the size of a state here.
Yeah, no offense to the French with the cheese. You know?
Yeah, no.
They got one cheese for every day of the year. That's none the deal there. So, but France has a lot of immigration from Eastern Europe, right? And so you have a lot of racism,
mm-hmm.
right? So the Polish people are coming over, right? And the Polish people are taking the jobs, right? So it's the same rhetoric. Just insert term here.
Yeah.
You're just changing
that's all
the person.
It is. Yeah. Or the Turkish people, right? A lot of Turkish people come into France. And they do a lot of the work that the rest of the Frenchies don't like to do.
Yeah.
Right? And I can say that because I'm freaking French.
Yeah.
Right?
But it's sad to say, like, basically human nature is just...
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
People that don't look and act the way you look and act.
Yeah.
It's just sad.
Yeah. But you also have a lot of political refugees that come from the Middle East, right?
Yeah.
You also have people that are literally like, they're refugees from countries that are war-torn.
War-torn, yeah.
Yeah.
And they have no control over where they're going. And places like, well, most Western European countries have been closing down their borders to these refugees. Like, we don't have room for you. Fuck you. You got plenty of country.
Yeah.
You're fine. Set up a fucking tent. Like, it'll be okay, you know? But you have these political agendas that are coming in, and they're saying, oh, sorry, you can't come in. You can't do this, right? And flipping it all the way back to parenting, what are you teaching your kids not allowing these people in the country? Everybody poops.
Right.
One of our daughter's favorite books. Yeah,
but don't be nice to people whose skin isn't the same as yours. Exactly. They're right? The same.
Yeah. Their shit's not the different color. It's the same fucking color.
Right.
Right? So...
Unless you had Taco Bell.
As with anything, I think it's like a fear-based mentality. If you're looking at things from a place of fear, you're going to be insecure and you're going to think someone's coming to take mine versus, you know, having a wealth mindset, you know, or a positive mindset of like, there's enough room for all of us. Come on in. Like, we'll figure it out. I'm not afraid that you're going to take my job from me or my whatever from me. So, you know, I think it's interesting to see how these same social issues play out across the world. You know, it's not just an American problem.
It's funny too, when you think like scientifically, right? I'm not talking about spirituality or whatever anybody's individual faith is, but scientifically, we all know that Pangea happened, right? The Earth was one continent at one point and it split. Mm-hmm. And it's almost like the cosmic challenge to humanity was they were like, all right, we're going to create distance, mm-hmm. which will create animosity, which will create tension, which will create fear, which will create a lack of understanding. Mm. Whereas like when you look at had that not happened, and everything was one central landmass, we wouldn't have been that different.
Possibly, but also people might have been looking for somewhere else to go.
There's nowhere else to go.
Well, yeah, maybe, I mean, I don't know.
Where would they go?
Yeah, it was
fall off the ground. That was it.
Fall off the ground. Like, you're a flat
earther. Step off the edge of the earth, dude. Come
they
on.
Could have built a boat, right? I'm built a boat. I'm out of here.
Water World.
That is such an underrated movie. I really like Waterworld.
Costner has a very underwhelming performance in that movie.
Yeah, but he is also a super underrated actor and desperately needs a comeback, and he was great in Superman. Anyway. Do you have any other questions?
I have one question.
Yeah, hit it.
And it's for the ladies. Oh. Sorry. What is something that you have learned about your partner that you didn't know pre-COVID?
Positively or negatively?
Their choice.
Just learned.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
So the thing, I think the biggest thing I've learned about him, which I've always known, but it really like came into clarity during COVID time.
Was it my gardening skills?
Oh, our poor garden.
How good he looks in sweatpants.
You guys didn't do a COVID garden? I thought everybody did.
We did. Yeah, we had green peppers, bell peppers, jalapenos. They lasted like till June because in August burnt everything. But we had, and marijuana.
Oh.
Yeah.
Obviously. That's important.
We just had tomatoes and then zucchini that squirrel ate. So we fed the squirrels.
Got it. That was sweet of you.
I think the biggest thing I've taken away is, and that I've learned about him, is just his level of like undying commitment to something. Like when he is like in on something, he is in on it. So like I've really been able to see that come out in terms of his like professional life and how much he is like dedicated to building that, but it all comes back to family. Like, and I think you've been talking so much about that. And it's like, it all funnels back into, he's such a provider and just wants to like be supportive and take care of us. And, so yeah, I've always known that about him, but definitely COVID has really like brought that to light and really made me see it in a way that I don't think I wouldn't have been able to see it in that way. Because, you know, we're home together so much now and you know, I'm seeing his drive. Like he's just honed in on it.
I got shit to do.
That was a nice thing. That must have been nice to hear. A nice thing to say.
That was very nice. I appreciate that, babe. I really do.
It's because it's true.
Thank you.
Mrs. Infamous?
I would have to say that one big thing, I mean, my husband's been through a lot of different professions, mostly like selling, but then over the last handful of years, it's been more marketing. And so through COVID, like he's kind of pushed us to have more out of the box thinking. I mean, we've done two home videos, one that I was in the video
They
for.
Were movies. They were not home videos. Okay. They were theatrical quality short films.
They were awesome.
Excuse me. But yes, so one that I was in on that's not that great. But the other one I filmed, which I'm very proud of. And
great job,
Beth. Yeah, thanks.
You had a hell of a tracking shot down the hall.
Right? I kept it steady and straight. And then the other one too, which was really kind of fun, was, you know, doing a glow stick video challenge where you turn the lights on, the glow sticks are lit, you kind of give yourself a face, and I had a grumpy man face. But, you know, like dancing to that and just, you know, being able to break up the redundance of COVID and having it feel the same, you know, for better or for worse day, but being able to bring some laughter and fun into it. So that was probably really cool.
Oh, that was really nice, both of them. Well done, gentlemen.
What can we say? We're awesome.
Thank you.
I'm learning that.
I think what's important to note, though, is that, you know, we wouldn't be us as men without our partners.
No. And I would like to answer your question, if you don't mind.
No, not at all.
I have learned through COVID that Mrs. is a far better employee than I will ever be in my entire life. Like, you don't understand a work day in your spouse's life until it's your day every fucking day over and over. Mm-hmm. And you have to navigate through it with her and make sure the kid's taken care of and, you know, the homeschooling and everything. I was doing most of that in the beginning because she is the most dedicated, hardest working team member I've ever met. She's incapable of failing at her job. She's not built to do it. And like, it's like 7 o'clock. She wanders down the hall, turns the coffee on, and is on the computer. There's no breakfast. There's no, you know, chilling outside, reading the paper, doing some yoga in the morning, whatever it is. Not that I'm implying she's not active. This is all complimentary. But she's in from the time she starts, no matter what I say, no matter how much complaining I do, no matter how much fucking complaining my kid does. Like, she's in no matter what. And she's seen the results of that come back to her in spades. And her company super respects her and is moving mountains and bridges to make sure that she stays on the team. She's works for a company where hundreds of thousands of people were furloughed on.
Yeah.
And she was never without a day of work through all of this.
Yeah.
And that only is because of who she is as a team member. And like I said, she's incapable of being shady or malicious or unintentional. Mm. And I've learned that through watching her in the kitchen. Yeah. And I don't always love it, but it's a good thing for our daughter to be able to see what it looks like. Cause I'm never going to fucking show her that. Mm. That quality will never escape me, you know? So it's good. We definitely, her weaknesses are my strengths and vice versa. And you see that when you have to see it. You know what I mean? When we're gone 8 hours a day, we have 3 hours a day together. It's fucking easy. Mm-hmm. Like, anyone that says marriage was tough before this can eat a dick. Oh, it's hard being with somebody for 3 hours a day? Fuck you.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, try doing it during, like, anyone that gets married after this and they bitch to us, right? We're like, fuck you. You try being home 24 hours a day with your spouse and children and school and two jobs and fucking life and toilet paper rations for 10 months. You don't know shit about marriage, right? We're going to become those old people like, when my day.
Absolutely.
Breakfast was whatever the fuck was left over from yesterday, and you didn't say shit about it.
Yeah.
So,
you know what I really noticed for us, like, this sounds stupid, but our food menu.
Mm. Right? You have to try new things, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
So we had like this schedule, this program, like, we would go grocery shopping once a week.
Yep.
Get all the stuff.
Those days are gone.
Right. You know, it's like, oh shit. Oh, there's no more steak.
Right.
Oh, damn it. Oh, Oh, ground turkey? Oh, that's gone.
Yeah, because cooking, yeah. cooking three meals a day is way fucking better than one. Yeah, because let's all be real. We weren't cooking lunches and breakfasts before this. It was very basic stuff. Mm-hmm. And dinner was always the dinner, right? Mm-hmm. But now, three full meals a day?
Yeah.
Sorry, I didn't mean to. Go ahead.
No, it's fine. Continue it's the same with thing. It's like, where's the penny? Right? It doesn't exist. Everybody bought it all.
Yeah.
Right?
And so you have to get
creative. Why'd you get these pickles?
Those were the pickles.
Yeah.
And so we would have to get creative. It's like, okay, well, we have this, this, and this. You know, this menu thing that we used to do, right? Every week we would like, oh, okay, we're going to have five meals that we're going to make at home this week. Mm-hmm. And these are the meals. That's gone.
Yeah.
That's out of here.
Yeah.
Right? Figure it out. Put together. Just, okay, put the mashed potato packet with the stuffing packet and the frozen chicken and see what happens.
Get some chips and salsa.
Yeah. And then if it sucks, sriracha.
Yeah. For sure. Our friends came out in May from the Midwest and they taught us fancy ramen.
Oh, yeah?
Which is fucking spectacular on a budget.
Let's do it.
So it's so stupid, but it's so good.
All right.
So it's just top ramen noodles. Four bricks of top ramen noodles, right? One packet of powder. Uh-huh. Get them bitches nice and good. You throw like 98 different sauces in it. Steak, sliced mushrooms, some onions for
everything
her.
Everything but the kitchen sink. Whatever you want in your ramen.
You're coming up with sauces you've never heard of, like hoisin sauce. And then you serve it, right? And it's like, oh my God, this is so fucking big. It's basically homemade Mongolian barbecue for like 98 cents.
That sounds great.
And like all the bottles will last you, you know, you could do it at least six times.
Let me know when you're going to do that. I'll come over.
Oh, I'll make fancy ramen for you. No problem. Okay.
We can do it in the driveway, you know, just to be safe.
Right. Yeah. Because California COVID. Uh-huh. Okay. I have a fighting question.
A fighting question? You mean a controversial question?
It may cause a fight on the way home.
Oh.
A question for
our drive isn't that long, so we don't have that much time.
Yeah. Good. 2 minutes to sort this out. This is for all of you. Okay. Including you over here.
All right.
Bug eyes. What is one of the negative things or the hardest things you've had to get used to about your spouse being home with COVID? Whoever wants to shit on their spouse first.
If I could start.
Sure.
It's actually like a reversal on to me. Like, I fart a lot.
Yep. I'm with you.
Do you clear the room?
So does my kid.
I'm used to that, though. Right, like, that's COVID thing, like, or not.
You know, COVID makes people...
intimate.
Constipated. Okay. And so you got...
because of all the sriracha, bro.
That's right. So you got some stuff that's, you know, just sitting in there, and then you fart, and it smells. And so one of the things that I really have had...
Are you trying to nicely say she has smelly farts?
No.
No, he's not talking about me.
No, she's like a flower garden. She's fine.
I know. This is infamous farts like once a week.
So, like, I'm actually kind of like getting ahead of this problem is what I'm doing right now.
Yeah.
This was not the problem I was going to bring up.
Boy. Let's skip straight to Alex.
Yep.
Are you done?
So are my farts, yes.
No, I would say, I think because I'm around him more, obviously, and he's having to work from home, the thing, and this probably won't be a surprise to you because we've talked about it, is I kind of get on him for, like, his phone usage and, like, wanting him to have better boundaries around.
Yeah,
like,
definitely.
Yeah, it's time
to put work away, like, you know, and not even just work, because for a while, he and I, and I'll take accountability for this too, because I was doing it too, it was like an escape to be on the phone, whether it was on social media or whatever, and it was totally a way to try to cope with everything that was happening.
Yeah.
And so, you know, I told him, I'm like, we got to have like phone-free time, because I feel my blood pressure rise if I see you're still on your phone.
And yeah, we do that too, yep.
And quality time for me is really important. It's like one of my love languages. Like I have to have quality time with my partner, or else I feel like we're not connected at all. And so if you're sitting on the couch next to me and you're on your phone, That does not count. We are not connected.
I hate second screening. Oh my God, it's such a pet peeve of mine. Crazy.
So that would be my biggest. That would be my biggest thing.
What's second screening?
It's when you're watching something with me and you're on, and I look to my right, and you're on your phone. Yeah. Oh, I want to fucking roundhouse kick somebody when that happens. It's like, have respect for this movie.
I'll make sure that I never do that ever.
Yeah, it's yeah. Mm. All right.
Well, Mr. Firefox is an essential worker.
So. He has a podcast name. Beanies, remember?
Yeah, but there was also something before that, I feel like.
I just call him sexy.
I know. He's your boyfriend.
Yeah, he is. I would. Oof.
Oof.
Yeah.
Yeah.
All right, just go with Mr. Firefox. That's fine.
Yeah, so he's been going to work. We haven't had that.
You don't have anything? No new fights? No nothing? You just have a perfect marriage?
Yes.
I'm going to call him. I should call him on the podcast and
run this. Call him right now.
Well, wait a second. So you mean he's been working the whole entire time, right?
Right.
Okay.
Crazy hours and everything.
Crazy hours. Okay. I don't know what he does, but I've also been working the whole entire time, but like I've been working like a normal day job, if you will. Right. So, but we still spend like a ton of time at home together. And so that's where all of the, more time together at home came from.
Yeah.
So for you though, you're saying that like nothing really changed as far as like how much time you spent together.
Right.
Well, that was easy.
Sorry. Sorry. Not to, can't be a little bit more dramatic. But.
Well, no. But so that's like definitely a dichotomy because you haven't had a like time intensive relationship where you're spending way more time together, you know, throughout the day.
Right.
Lucky.
Well, and I think she would want to at the same token.
It sounds nice on the surface.
But he's so cute.
Oh, he is. But, like, I would do, like, ideal, I've learned for me personally now, like, my ideal work week moving forward would be I could work 3 days from home and 2 days in the office, and that could be my life forever now. I don't think I would ever voluntarily, you'd have to drag me kicking and screaming to go back to 5 hours or 5 days a week in an office building.
Yeah.
Like, I'm good on that for the rest of my life.
I agree 100%.
Yeah. It's like, I've always been a proponent for the four-day work week.
Yeah, 4-10s.
Yeah, 4-10s all fucking day.
Or 4-4s.
Yeah, oh, yeah, even better. But it's funny that you say that because my criticism was going to be that. And is that, and again, you heard my praise for her work ethic, so it's in no way impugning that.
Of course.
But for me, like I essentially have had four jobs for the entire time for COVID. I have a contract job that I do as my day job. Mm-hmm. I drive 3 shifts of DoorDash a day.
Wow.
This podcast, there's 4 podcasts that require 4 separate social media channels across 3 different outlets for each one, which is hours of editing and then promoting and getting guests and all these things. This is essentially another job.
Yeah, of course.
And then I have this job I was telling you about outside where I'm trying to develop Infamous Works into people hiring my marketing.
As a firm. Yeah.
And that's the goal.
It is a firm.
It is.
I just need building.
I just need more clients. And ultimately, that's my dream is I don't want to work for anyone else ever fucking again. Mm-hmm. I want to work for you and help you fulfill your dream and put your vision to be your business tool. But that's the you I want to work for. And then I want to give you some knuckles and walk out of your life and never see you again. And where she is like, all right, I'm going to work my hours and then my day's done.
Yeah.
And she does also have a second job that she does a couple times a month, but we just have a very different work ethic in that, like, for me, I don't believe in a single source of income. I never have. Mm-hmm. And I, with no disrespect to anyone in here that believes that or anyone listening, just, I think it's a dangerous way to live your life because you're essentially empowering your ability to support your family into someone else's ability to keep you employed. Mm-hmm. And what I've learned through COVID is like, there is no such thing as loyalty. It doesn't matter how fucking good you are at your job. If somebody hasn't managed their company properly, you're out. Mm-hmm. It doesn't. And I've watched people cry their eyes out to lay people off. You know, they don't want to do it any more than you want to be laid off. But like, I've learned through this, like I have got to be able to rely on myself. If I get the call and they're like, guess what? We're closing because of COVID. It can't affect me. It cannot affect our income. It cannot affect our credit scores. It cannot affect our lifestyle.
Yeah.
And that's, and she's just a little bit different on that. And I have, I'm critical on it at times, but I also have to accept, like, we're two different people. Yeah. It doesn't make her right or her wrong or me right.
Yeah.
It just makes the way that we look at it differently. And for me, when I look at supporting my family, like you said, it's financially, mm-hmm. right? My family can exist without me because Mrs. Infamous is a good mom. And she's a great parent and a good role model. And my daughter can have her as a single parent if I die tomorrow and turn out great, right? But my input on that is like making sure that they don't need to ever check the price tag of something. Mm-hmm. And that, and teaching my kid about the value of money. You know, that's, I spoil my kid because I'm a dad and she's a little girl. But I also, she's on commission and she has to earn her money. And I'm teaching her about recycling and how you can earn money different ways. And doing a lemonade stand in a garage sale. Because I want her to take her best work ethics and then my financial drive, and she'll be unstoppable.
Right.
She'll never need a man for her entire life, you know? And she'll choose to have a partner at that point because mm-hmm. she can, not because she needs to. And that's just kind of like, and we fight about it, and we're, and it's hard to have a fight where neither of us are right or neither of us are wrong. That's the worst fight to have. It'd be much easier to fight about whether the sky is blue because it'd be like, well, it's blue. Well, technically, it's transparent, and it's the light reflecting off the ocean.
It's the ocean.
Yeah.
That's it.
But, I mean, to have a fight where we're both right and both wrong is very frustrating. Mm-hmm. So that's my...
I think one thing that I've always thought about, and I don't know where this really comes from. It might be, like, some old Midwestern folklore or something like that. But I think that in a relationship, everybody has a department. Right.
Yeah.
So you have a department where
your strengths,
you no longer put meat on a grill.
Right.
Right. And she makes a mean steak in a cast iron skillet.
Right.
Right. And that's her department now.
Yeah.
Right. And so we all have these different things that we do and we contribute to a relationship or a family. And it just kind of falls into place. And if it doesn't fall into place, well, you got to talk about what you want. Mm-hmm. And that's one of the most important parts of parenting, because if you're not aligned, your kid is going to be totally off balance. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So talk to each other.
Yep.
Just talk. I mean, that's one of the fundamental things of being parents, being in a relationship.
And listen, like you said earlier, I mean, yeah, we can listening. Talk and talk and talk and talk and talk. I think most people are really good at talking. Listening's really hard, and yeah. and actively listening is a skill.
Yeah. And then applying.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Right.
Mr. Infamous and I have, for a long time, been in various sales roles in mm-hmm. our professional careers.
Yep.
And one of the things that people fail to do, salespeople fail to do, is listen.
Mm-hmm.
Because in order to fulfill someone's needs, you have to know what they are.
Can't ask for the sale without the...
Without knowing story. What they want.
Yep.
So, listen to your people.
Well, we are running out of time, but Mrs. Infamous, you get to now shit on me as the closing argument of this episode. So, what is the thing during COVID that has driven you most bonkers about myself or negatively learned about me or whatever vernacular you want to use to describe me as a piece of shit?
No, I would just say that one of the biggest struggles is the fact that you have lost hearing in one ear. So you were very loud at times. And so having,
times.
Yeah.
At all times.
Well, okay, you said it.
Yeah.
But having meetings that are Zoom and having your bosses on the other end or executives or whoever that meeting entails, and then having chip bags open.
Wait, you don't like when you're on a meeting and I walk out of the hallway like this? Hello! Because that happens regularly.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Quite often, yeah. Where I like hear a door close and instantly it's me.
Come on, I've gotten better. And I'll come in the room and I'll be like...
Oh, no. But you've already opened the bag of chips by that point and then ask, are you on mute? You should mute yourself.
I agree.
And then it's just clanging.
I agree with what you're saying and I hear you, but I would also like to recommend...
Did you hear?
That if you wanted a... If you would like a quiet place to conduct your business, there is a room right here... Where I won't be banging my chest in.
No, that's the problem.
You choose to do business in our kitchen.
Yes, but I started in the garage. because it was my free zone.
And yeah, but it was too hot. I couldn't have you out here in the summer. It was like 120 degrees out here. I'm not an asshole.
I was okay with it. It got peace and quiet.
All right, well, then you can start back in the garage.
Yeah. Oh, and hence, winter. It's freezing now.
Yeah. Podcasting during the winter in here sucks.
Yeah, see.
It's not Minnesota.
Well, when it's 10 degrees in here and you have a guest, it's like,
a parka with a sweatshirt, with Ugg boots, with.
I'll never forget, we had a guest in here in February when we first switched it out here. And she was in, like she said, okay, so she was in a thermal, a hoodie, a parka with fuzz, gloves, and pants, right? And she's sitting the entire interview like, so I'm relieved. I'm like, dude, for real? Then I had to buy this heater, but she can't have the heater on during the recording. So we have to have it on all day. And then it's like, okay, quick, go. Say everything you want to say in 20 minutes or it's going to get cold. So, all right, I hear you, babe. Thank you. I will continue to work on not being so loud.
Okay.
All right. Well, Alex Steric, thank you so much. We're going to get more into her mental health prowess and all the wonderful things she is doing for the children of the Kaneo and Ventura County areas. In a very close upcoming episode, she's launching a new project, which we are going to piggyback on and help you guys learn all about in December, most likely. Yes?
Yes.
Okay. So we'll be revisiting with Alex in December. If you are in a situation where your child is seeking attention, help, you have questions, concerns, you can reach out to Alex via?
So best way would be my website. So alexstericlcsw.com, and you'll get all my contact information off of there. You can also find me on social media. But yeah, children, parenting needs, teens, adults, I pretty much see everyone across the lifespan. So anybody, everybody, feel free to reach out.
Perfect. Well, I'm looking very much forward to talking to you. Steven, if you need work done or a complete kitchen remodel, or you need a house built, or
all of that,
yeah. can
real estate advice, anything you guys need,
you can find him
at Stephen Steric on all platforms, Steric on all platforms.
And that's Stephen with a ph.
With a ph. That's right.
With a ph. If you spell that shit with a v, it is on.
You'll get the wrong guy.
Yeah, you get the wrong Steric. You'll get an upside down kitchen. Yeah. And he will not be responsible.
Yeah, good luck for your flapjacks.
Yeah. You can follow the ladies at Mrs. Infamous or at TIC Firefox.
Firefox_TIC.
Yeah.
But
listen to their show. They had the opportunity to sit down with Alex before we did at Maternal Instincts. That actually came out today as well. So look at them at Maternal Pod on all of the socials and follow them, Mrs.Infamous and Firefox_TIC. Yep. Follow us if you're not. You're an asshole. At Infamous Chronicles. Go on to letsbeinfamous.com. Buy some merch for the holidays. Use promo code Infamous to save $10. And if you haven't already done it, please also check out our friends at Civvy's Apparel. You've heard the whole spiel. 10% of all of their sales go to local veterans organizations. Use our promo code Chronicles20 to save 20% off your purchase. It makes great gifts, and I swear their clothes not only look awesome, I get complimented on them everywhere I wear them, but they're super comfortable. So thank you very much for listening this week, and stay healthy, stay positive, stay supportive of each other, and don't get divorced. If I was you, I'd wanna be me too. I'd wanna be me too. I'd wanna be me too. Thank you for listening to this week's episode of the Infamous Chronicles. This episode was recorded, produced, and edited live in the Infamous Work Studios in Los Angeles, California. We want to note that all of the statements made in this and all previous episodes are the opinions of the hosts of those episodes and do not in any way, shape, or form reflect fact. We do not carry any copyright use of the music in this episode. We are simply fans of it. If you're interested in contacting us, please email us at info@infamousworks.com with any guest or topic suggestions. And go ahead and give a listen to our sister shows, Weed Wednesdays, Maternal Instincts, Discussing Depression, and Murder of Nerds. Thank you for listening to this week's episode, and we'll see you next time on the Infamous Chronicles.